In the name of the Father, of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Holy Father, we ask you for your Holy Spirit today. Help us to understand this gospel, to receive it, that this gospel can come like a food, nourish our soul, our heart, that without food we are hungry and we can eat something that's not healthy for us. Help us, Lord, through this gospel to nourish our soul. Amen. The Lord be with you. A reading from the Holy Gospel according to Mark. After John had been arrested, Jesus came to Galilee proclaiming the gospel of God. This is the time of fulfillment. The kingdom of God is at hand. Repent and believe in the gospel. As he passed by the Sea of Galilee, he saw Simon and his brother Andrew casting their nets into the sea. They were fishermen. Jesus said to them, "Come after me, and I will make you fishers of men." Then they abandoned their nets and followed him. He walked along a little further and saw James, the son of Zebedee, and his brother John. They too were in a boat mending their nets when he called them. So they left their father Zebedee in the boat along with the hired men and followed him. The Gospel of the Lord. Today's Gospel is very interesting. It's about Jesus calling the disciples, and in his choice there is a great surprise. But let me give you a background. Jesus is calling disciples. Jesus knows that he's planning to build something of, I don't know how to even say, immense importance. Jesus is trying to build the church. This church is meant to change the world. So if you are going to pick up the people who will work for you, and those people will take part in the most important enterprise ever devised by humanity, you choose wisely. And whom do you choose? If you have a business, and it's an important business, you're a banker, whom do you choose? You choose people with experience. You choose people with degrees. You choose people who are good at the work. So, you know, if you have CVs of 100 people, you look at the CV and say, this guy is the best of all candidates, I take him for me. So if I am looking for disciples to build the kingdom of God, it seems that Jesus should choose whom? Well, the best of the best. And what is the best? We think. The best is a man who prays a lot. The best is a man who has a great relationship maybe with God. Maybe he has experience. You know, Jesus goes around announcing the kingdom of God. And then someone who speaks well, is articulated, and has a great knowledge of scriptures, this guy can give a message. And well, you know, he will be very useful for my kingdom. You have to look for the people who are strong in faith. We don't want the people who have doubts, who are sinning, who are wimps, I don't know. They will not be good workers. And yet Jesus doesn't look at any of that. He happens to pass on the seashore. He looks, there are fishermen working, and catching fish has nothing to do with the kingdom of God, with preaching the gospel, with praying. It's not religious activity. And he says, you guys follow me. And that's an important message for us, that Jesus says and clarifies what is important for him to be a disciple. Who is going to be a great disciple? Well, there's only one criterion. Only a person that say yes to the call can be a great disciple. In the Bible we have, in the Gospel, those stories of people who are called and they say no. I am busy. I have to bury my father. I am rich. I don't want to sell my things. And they say no when the Lord calls them. But others, they say yes. And now real discipleship starts. Being disciple for Jesus is more than just learning from the master intellectual stuff. You live with master. You see the master. You know the master, which is Jesus. And this relationship transforms you. So when you look at the final product, Peter, after resurrection of Jesus, he's a man who is fearless, who is zealous, who announces the gospel with his life, who lives for the kingdom of God and nothing else. And someone looking at that can say, well, that's too much, that's not for me, you know. I'm just a simple guy, I'm a farmer, you know. This religious stuff is not for me. But Peter is like this because he went through all the journey with the Lord. In the beginning he wasn't. The journey has changed him. So that's first thing about discipleship. Everyone is called. And those who answer yes, those stay with the Master, and Master changes them. The second is that there is something very interesting about the fisherman. I once read a book that opened my eyes to that. The author compared hunting with fishing, and I think it's a good example for people who live in Yukon. I've been there and I learned what I know about hunting from them because I've never been a hunter. But there are some basic differences between hunting and the fishermen of the time of Jesus. When you hunt, you need skills. You have to know the animal. You have to know how to read the tracks. You have to know how to read the wind. You have to know how to shoot and have the skills with that. You need a good weapon, calibrated, and so on and so forth. And you need a license. So first, it is a skill-based activity. Second, the hunter chooses its prey. You buy a license and let's say you want to shoot a grizzly. When you go through the forest, you ignore deer's tracks, you ignore moose, you don't have even license. And then, of course, all your plan, all your hunting is planned around your prey. And if you want to shoot a moose, you have to call it. So, again, its entire trip is moose-oriented. And fishermen are not like that. Fishermen at the time of Jesus did a very simple job. You cast the nets and you pull them. You cast them and you pull them. It's a heavy physical work, but it's not a skill work. You just, within a day, you can be a good fisherman. Second, you don't know ever what you catch. You cast the net and you hope for your luck. Sometimes you pull a big, nice fish. Often you pull absolutely nothing. And sometimes you pull and it's garbage, you know, shoes or other stuff. So the only thing that is needed for a fisherman is patience. And I see that often people confuse hunting with fishing. They want to hunt the people. How? Well, my children don't go to church. I have to hunt them. My spouse is not a believer. I have to hunt my spouse. And to be a disciple of Jesus is to be a fisherman. In other words, you cast your nets. What does it mean to cast the nets? You live as a Christian. You speak about God. You give testimony to what God did in your life. And you love as Christ. And you forgive as Christ. And you cast the nets. Often, nothing comes in. Nothing. Absolutely nothing. Sometimes garbage comes in. Sometimes comes a big fish. Someone is moved and comes to Jesus. Encounter Jesus. And we rejoice. But fisherman has to be a patient. They have to accept that the one who is behind, who really catches the fish, is the Lord. And I'm just working for him. But there's very important detail, I think, also in that gospel for us. Those fishermen that are called by Jesus, they are cleaning their nets. And that's what we can always do. You want to catch the fish? Your nets have to be clean. So what does it mean? I look at myself. I have to clean myself. I have to trace every sin, every vice, everything that is wrong in me. If I am calling people to the kingdom of God, and I am a proud man, I am a jealous man, I am an angry man, I am a greedy, lustful man, my net is dirty. Not many fish would be caught. So with the Lord, I am cleaning my nets. I am searching for arrogancy, for superiority, for resentments, for judges. I am doing a scrutiny or examination of my conscience daily, daily and daily. And that sometimes when we focus on others, I want to bring Jesus to others, we don't think about that. We lose that perspective. I want to bring others to Christ, my nets have to be clean first. Holy Father, we ask you for this gospel. We thank you for this gospel. Thank you that you are calling all of us to work for you, that we can share the joy of your kingdom with others, of salvation, of your love, of your mercy. Help us to have our nets always clean, and that we can be useful workers in your work. To you glory forever and ever. Amen.